partecipare al ciclo di avvenimenti dedicati al futurismo italiano. Prima di presentare il nostro relatore di stasera, Thomas Schumacher, vorrei presentare inoltre Alessandro Borghesi e Sergio Illuminato, che rappresentano il ciclo dedicato al futurismo.
Noi volevamo, in nome del Movimento Culturale Romano che ha promosso questa iniziativa, prima di tutto ringraziare l'Accademia d'America per essere con noi in questo viaggio intorno al futurismo. Abbiamo iniziato il 16 novembre con un convegno scientifico a Villa Madama, dove hanno partecipato tutti i membri del comitato scientifico ed è stato presieduto dal professor Maurizio Calvesi. Abbiamo due mostre portanti, uno alle scuderie di Palazzo Ruspoli, Atmosfere Futuriste, Traballa, Francolini ed Etero, curato dal professor Crispolti, che sarà aperta fino al 31 gennaio con circa 150 opere. Un'altra al Museo del Genio Militare che riapre per questa occasione, dove ci sono tutti gli strumenti più importanti, le scoperte più importanti del primo Novecento, come la prima radio di Marconi, il primo aereo Blériot, la prima macchina fotografica, insieme a un percorso di quadri e di parole futurista. Degli incontri
E poi degli
internazionali.
incontri internazionali, questa è la seconda tappa. Abbiamo aperto questi incontri grazie all'Università di Roma La Sapienza, all'Accademia d'Ungheria. Abbiamo parlato un po' dell'attivismo, che era quel movimento che appunto si diffondeva in quel periodo contemporaneamente al futurismo in Italia, invece nella loro nazione. Adesso il secondo appuntamento è qui per parlare in qualche modo del neofuturismo, o comunque la accennerà in maniera molto specificata il professor Schumacher. E poi avremo ancora un appuntamento lunedì a Piazza Navona, all'Accademia, al Centro Culturale del Brasile, per parlare del concretismo, quindi come l'esperienza dei futuristi si diffuse invece nel Brasile. E quindi lascio invece adesso la parola, ritornando a ringraziarla, all'Accademia Americana. Buonasera. Come ho detto, è un piacere per noi di ospitare un tappo, no, questo viaggio, come è stato definito. Penso che Thomas Schumacher è conosciuto le persone presenti, ma allo stesso momento, per chi non lo conosce, vorrei dedicare qualche parola a lui prima della sua relazione. Thomas Schumacher è un ex borsista dell'Accademia e residente attuale in architettura. Occupa negli Stati Uniti la cattedra di architettura all'Università di Maryland. Ha ricevuto la laurea e anche la specializzazione in architettura a Cornell University, dove ha studiato in particolare con Colin Rowe. È stato dopo associato con gli studi di architettura di Brown Daltus e di I.M. Pei, e inoltre è stato associato all'Institute for Architecture and Urban Studies di Peter Eisenman. Negli Stati Uniti ha guadagnato una fama di insegnante perspicace e rigoroso di architettura e di disegno. Molti suoi allievi sono usciti dall'Università di Princeton, dall'Università di Virginia, dall'Università di Maryland, per portare la sua preparazione, il suo insegnamento al tavolo di disegno. È stato inoltre autore di due libri apprezzati sull'architetto italiano Giuseppe Terragni, Il Pantheon di Terragni di 81 e poi più recenti Surface and Symbol, Giuseppe Terragni and the Architectural Tradition of Italian Rationalism. A questo momento, in questa stagione, all'Accademia Vaticana conduce ricerche sull'architettura romana, palazzetti di Monteverdi e Monte Testaccio. Parlerà stasera sul retaggio di futurismo nell'architettura contemporanea. La sua relazione sarà seguita da una discussione che condurrà professor Schumacher e poi dopo da un ricevimento che offre l'Accademia Americana sul pian terreno. Sono molto contento di presentare ora il mio vecchio amico Thomas Schumacher.
Grazie Mac e grazie Sergio e Alessandra. Sono molto felice di stare qua. Non aver paura, non parlerò per tutto l'intervento in italiano, però volevo incominciare di fare una spiegazione all'inizio dell'intervento che sto facendo stasera. Non parlerò sul futurismo, non parlerò neanche sull'arte di oggi, l'arte contemporanea. Parlo un'avanguardia internazionale, non solo americana, dell'architettura moderna, proprio di oggi, che è chiamato deconstructivism, decostruttivismo. È una parola interessante perché è un mélange fra costruttivismo e deconstruction. Uno viene dall'architettura russa degli anni 20 e l'altro viene dalle ricerche in letteratura e altri campi dell'arte degli ultimi 20 anni. È una parola che è molto importante per l'architettura, per spiegare, per sentire l'architettura, e io voglio convincervi stasera che la parola è sbagliata. Sono infatti convinto che, come nel passato, questo non uscirà così. Infatti, la parola razionalismo per l'architettura dell'avanguardia italiana degli anni 20-30 non si può cambiare. Quando è nata una parola, vive per qualche anno. Allora, quindi incomincio così, sapendo che sarebbe proprio impossibile convincere gli architetti internazionali, specialmente inglesi e americani, di cambiare la parola deconstructivist, di diventare la parola neo-futurist. In ogni modo, incomincio di fare un tentativo di convincervi qua. Adesso incomincio a parlare in inglese. This is not about deconstruction, and it's not about futurism. It's about what I like to call back to the futurism. È uscito in Italia quel film, no? Back to the Future, ecco. Beniamino Placido has said something like, the future is always the same, it's the past that changes. I think that's probably true, because images of the future, or what the present tends towards in the future, or what the present is leading to, are always quite similar. For one thing, it's usually, but not always, very clean. It's usually populated by a series of images that are already existent in the present, ideas that become generalizable for repetitive things in architecture. That is, the idea of, as it was the case in the original futurism, the idea of images of electrical power plants becoming forms that could be used for housing, for instance. In architecture schools and magazines around the globe, there is a new architecture that has made itself felt in a rather exciting and extraordinary way. It's called deconstructivism, and it heralds the eclipse of the ancien regime, which has been around for about 15 or 20 years, which we've called postmodernism. And this question about what constitutes architectural postmodernism and what constitutes postmodernism in other areas is very important. This new style, by the way, is almost everywhere. It hasn't gotten in a lot into Italy, although there's a little bit of it, and it certainly has been almost excluded from the architectural work of both the practitioners and the academics in Switzerland. It's been fueled by the publishing industry. There are already three, by now there may be more, issues on deconstructivism that have come out of the London-based architectural design magazine. This new style announces the eclipse of the old modernism. from the international style and the new objectivity to the new brutalism, to the new irrationalism. Virtually all of the other movements of the last 70 years have been ousted, except futurism and constructivism. Now, could we have the first slide? Possiamo avere le diapositive all'inizio? Grazie. Per me è molto meglio parlare quando non c'è luce. Lights, please. Se ci sono le luci non posso, non si può, ecco, va bene, anche l'altro lì. It's probably unfair and oversimplified to lump all of those buildings and those architects of this new orthodoxy of diagonal intersections, glass shards, and asymmetrical unbalance into a single category of deconstructivism. I'm not going to explain all the slides, by the way, or at least I'm not going to explain them very very completely. This happens to be a house by Coop Himmelblau, an Austrian firm. Almost all the slides, I think the ones that you will recognize as not being deconstructivist are going to be fairly obvious. Deconstructivism, or decon, as it is often called, is obviously a misnomer. It is like the term rationalism used to denote the avant-garde in Italy of the 1920s and the 1930s. But since the term is already in widespread use, and since we can easily recognize a duck when it appears in a full-page magazine spread, I will employ the D word here with a rather broad brush to include all of those buildings and architects with what I consider to be a similar quack. Daniel Libeskind's Jewish extension to the Berlin Museum of a couple of years ago. The new architecture is supposed to be the architecture of angst, of pain, of turmoil. Peter Eisenman, my former boss and one of the style's most vocal proponents, has called it the architecture of the post-nuclear, post-Holocaust age. This new style seeks to replace this ancien regime, postmodernism. But the new architecture is not the old modernism. It is an architecture grounded in the realities, supposedly, of today. It's hypermodern. It's interesting, by the way, decon has actually pulled off a terminology coup. It's a little bit like the Red Guards during the Cultural Revolution. The decons are more modern than thou. It's like the Hawks, who commandeered the American flag during the Vietnam War. Modernity has become the exclusive domain of those architects who use multiple diagonals, tilt-out walls, and plan rotations. I apologize, by the way, for the slides. It's another drama about the slides here. I finally got them today, and unfortunately, they're a little bit underexposed. This coup, by the way, it has an interesting parallel. It parallels the original modern movement architects of the 1920s and 1930s. Like their counterparts in the interwar period, deconstructivist architects and their apologists have usurped the term modern. It's the only modern game in town, apparently. By the way, architectural theory in general tends to be, and the polarization of it, tends to be very much like politics in a banana republic. It's you're either a communist or a fascist, and apparently nothing in between. You're either a decon or you're a pomo, and with the exception of architects who really don't care about what goes on in the magazines, people have difficulty existing in between. Now, there were modernist architects in the 20s and 30s who were made to feel not modern enough as well. Perret, Cray, Ponti, Behrens, Dudok, Saarinen, they were also modern architects, but the historiography of modern architecture doesn't let them in. Deconstructivism is not a revival of modernism of the 20s and 30s, particularly as regards social agenda. It comes, in America at least, at the end of the Reagan period, or at least one hopes the end of the Reagan period. It is not involved in the same kinds of ideas of organization of space for use or the role of advanced technology. Advanced technology for decon is representational. It's not instrumental. It abjures the neorealisms of the 40s. It abjures and eschews the optimism of the 50s, the social determinisms of the 60s, the postmodernisms and neo-rationalisms of the 70s, and certainly the bourgeois formalism of the early 80s. Decan, we are told, has brought back the human body, but it is now the body in pain. One wonders whether the human body was ever lost, but that's another question. The new architecture is propelled by an intellectual fuel, which I think is composed by a kind of élan vital, a pure symbolic essence. Its legitimization is based upon its capacity to represent today through pure charisma. What this may mean in historical, intellectual, and logical terms is, I think, interesting to consider. And in this intervento, I'm going to examine first the basis of deconstructivism's self-justifications. I then will question some of deconstructivism's avowed purposes, in particular the need to reflect the presumably contemporary zeitgeist of angst and uncertainty. I will conclude with what I reckon to be deconstructivism's real essence, which is, I think, a highly decorative style, less revolutionary than and less different from Pomo than most proponents would like to admit. But most importantly, I will argue why deconstructivism would be better called neo-futurism. Sorry again for the dark slide. This is Zaha Hadid's Moonsoon restaurant in Sapporo, Japan. Let's go into the sort of basis now. During the period that architects call the first machine age, the German philosopher and economic theorist Max Weber wrote a book called The Theory of Social and Economic Organization. I think that's the proper title. I don't have a copy of it here. In it, he set out a set of ideas about how governments, regimes, and socioeconomic systems justify their existence. Weber identified what he called the pure forms of legitimate authority. They were the rational, the traditional, and the charismatic. Nations, peoples, and governments consider themselves to have legitimacy, Weber argued, because of rational or traditional reasons or via the charisma of their leaders or ideologies. This is not difficult to illustrate, obviously, although the pure forms are rather hard to find in any particular governmental system, especially in the century. The divine right of kings, an extreme version of the traditional, no longer passes muster in most monarchies. Obviously, the British royal family may retain a traditional right to the throne, but not to govern. Now, in the modern world, the pure forms are obviously intertwined. They resemble certain chemical elements, sodium, for example, those of you who have taken chemistry. I remember in chemistry lab, we would be shown the sodium, and it would burn up right away. These elements can exist only in free in nature, only in compounds or ores. Western democracies are widely accepted to be primarily rational systems with strong traditions, like the Anglo-American legal system. They exude a modicum of charisma, but these governments never possess so much charisma that it overshadows the rational. Tradition still obviously dominates in places like Saudi Arabia. Nazi Germany and fascist Italy relied heavily on charisma, and they more or less discarded tradition, or at least they said they discarded tradition. Rationality was almost non-existent. You'll remember Mussolini, the famous dictum, Mussolini ha sempre ragione, Mussolini is always right, itself demonstrating beautifully such a lack of rationality. Socialist societies tend to, or try, they think they balance the rational and the charismatic, and the traditional has very little part in the system. That's, of course, in theory. Now, obviously, Weber's lens could be placed neatly over the phenomenon of architecture, for that matter, architecture and urbanism. I suppose it probably could be placed over the phenomena of other artistic expressions, painting, sculpture, and the like. I won't do that. I happen to believe, by the way, that there's very little overlap between architecture and other artistic disciplines. I'll make the arguments a little later on of exactly why. Renaissance, of course, architects elaborated a rational system in a parade of treatises. They also blatantly paraded their love of tradition. The Greek revival in the 19th century was short on the rational, long on the traditional. Villiers-le-Duc tried to rationalize the charismatic. Mendelssohn attempted to raise the rational to the level of the charismatic. Without pressing the point too far, I think it might be reasonable to assert that a balanced, a deep, and a significant architecture needs nourishment from each of these groups, so to speak, the rational, the charismatic, and the traditional. Like firmitas, commoditas, and venustas, well-building requires at least something of all three. Now, of those influential movements of our century, certainly futurism was the most directly and purely charismatic. No, it wasn't entirely charismatic. This, I think, helps us understand quite well the relationship between Marinetti and Mussolini, for example, which has, by the way, been argued quite effectively. Joel's book, Three Intellectuals in Politics, I think, is an excellent argument. Constructivism, while proposing a kind of rational ideal, was also heavily charismatic. Neither of these movements were interested at all in tradition. Now, architects closer to the